Church in Jackson, New Hampshire, where Ronald and Alice gave so much of their love and their time to this community and put down roots, and where their love goes on. And I want to say today, first of all, that it is okay to cry. This is the time and the place to be present to your hearts and your minds and your bodies, which are wise in their own way. And if you feel that you need to cry, please, this is the place to share that, because it is an expression of the depth of your affection and your love for a man that we are remembering and celebrating today. Hopefully, there are Kleenex in all the pews, maybe little packs by the hymnals. If not, share with your neighbors in the pew before or behind you, please. My name is Gail Pomeroy Doctor. I'm a minister here at Jackson Community Church. I'm honored to share the service today with my colleague, Reverend Dr. Marlena Schmidt, who actually hails at the moment from the North Shore of Massachusetts, which is my old stomping ground. So there you go, we're all connected one way or another. And Marlena is a dear friend of the family and has been present through many of the significant moments of their lives. We hope you will all take time, sometime today, to share your stories with the family. There will be a light lunch offered after the service, so please feel free to remain, partake, and share stories, and celebrate the life of this beloved man. Please join me now in prayer. Okay. in the songs of our patriarchs, in the prayers of our ancestors, our mothers and our fathers. They called out to God, saying, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. And the promise of this great love that has endured from generation to generation and story to story is that God is our keeper. God will shade us with his right hand, and the sun will not strike us by day nor the moon by night. And the Lord will keep us, will keep our lives from our going out until our coming in, from this time on and forevermore. We give thanks for a love that holds us through our first breath, through every step and laugh and moment, until we leave this world and go into the next life and the great love that awaits us. And we give thanks that we can be here together to share stories and bear witness and know that we are never alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please rise if you are able. You should find in your bulletins the words to pour the beauty of the earth. If you don't find the words in your bulletin, you can find them in the red pew hymnal, Psalm number 54.
Thank you.
may be seated. Let's just pause for a moment and be in silent prayer with the relatives who... Is it Mark's brother?
Yeah,
Dick. Just need a moment and we'll just hold him in our thoughts and in our hearts and in our prayer as he feels the pain that he's feeling because of the deep love that Gail has.
And meanwhile, one of the special moments this morning is a performance of a song that was written for the bicentennial of Jackson during the time when Ron served as the president of the Historical Society. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to close the door so that there's a little bit more privacy. And if anybody else feels that you need to take care of yourself, there are bathrooms back here. If you're struggling to hear, we have assistive listening devices. Please let an usher know, and we can help you with that as well. Okay? So, take care of yourself as you need to. But we would love your music. Thank you.
I want to thank Dennis and David for their music. They're always playing with Shenandoah on a Saturday night in the morning. Along with really good pizza, by the way. Irish pizza. The first scripture reading the family has chosen for today is from the Old Testament Hebrew Scriptures, Book of Ecclesiastes, Chapter 3. It speaks of the natural rhythms of life. You may recognize the words, I'm sure you will. It was actually made into a song in the 60s by the Birds. I'm not going to sing it. But may we find comfort in these words. For everything, there is a season, and there is a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones, and time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. God has made everything suitable, even beautiful, for its time. Here ends the first reading. The second reading is from the New Testament, from the letter of the Apostle Paul, the first letter to the Corinthians. It's from chapter 13, again, a familiar reading that speaks of love. I've always thought of it as the love of God, but it's a love that we're called to emulate. And it's also, as I was reading this again in preparation for this service, it struck me that the way that this love is described here is the way that Ron chose to live his life. So may we hear God's Spirit speaking to us through these words. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have and I deliver my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. It is not arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrong, but rejoices in the right. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. So faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. And the family asks that she will pray with us together or be with us together. Psalm 23, which is the great comfort that we often turn to in times when we are distressed or sorrowing and we need a hope and a sense of God's presence and love's abiding within us. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down. Restore my soul. He leadeth me in
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
We would invite Molly forward. This is Ron's granddaughter offering her gift of music. So we come now to the time of sharing words of remembrance. And all of Ron's children have words to share, and so we invite forward first Donald.
I promised to go by the script and not go off the script, and I would try to adjust that. Remembering Dad, a good-natured smile, a firm handshake, and then helpful or playful at any opportunity. About 8 years ago, Mom and Dad moved to New London. That was a big deal, and as you can imagine, moving from Jackson to New London, there was quite a bit of stuff to sort through. It was quite a labor, but every so often, there was a gem. Like a draft of a note from my dad to his grandson, Ron II, it was written out on a 3x5 card. It was prompted by a photo, and I guess it was a selfie that young Ron snapped with his very fun-loving grandfather, who was handing it up disproportionately for the benefit of his grandson's camera. The draft of the note reads, "As I study the picture, I marvel urbane and reasonable you appear to be. Parentheses. However, in the future, tuck your necktie knot up to fill the space in your car. And what a total jerk I appear to be. And this is the part that blew me away. Even though we both know that I'm a suave, sophisticated, well-educated, ex-jet fighter pilot who married well, such that excellent genes are coursing through your body as I write. Chatting about his Air Force days was always a fun topic for our coffee sessions, and it was a safe topic for our coffee session. It didn't test his knowledge, really. The details in his stories, they continued to fade, but when he would occasionally become concerned about his memory, well, then I could prove to him it just comes and goes. And I did so with the initials of some of his Air Force buddies. Without explanation, I could say, MRD. He'd just shout out, Mike Pater. And I'd say, and the R? Robertson. I said, okay. How about FIS? Frank Irving Smith. I said, I'm quitting while I'm behind. He was relaxed and confident again. I'd pick up my coffee, nod. He'd pick up his coffee and just say, cheers. We'd sit quietly for a bit and start another story. According to the staff at Woodcrest, Dad's cheers were infectious. Cocktail hour cheers, I certainly understand that one. But cheers with orange juice at breakfast. Every moment of every day was to be celebrated somehow. One morning after a round of cheers at Dunkin' Donuts, I heard a young girl at the next table whisper, kind of loudly and excitedly, to her mother, Mom, can we do cheers? Having coffee with Dad in London for a couple of years was very rewarding. Within 6 months or so, we were adopted by the coffee seniors. These people sometimes refer to themselves as the table of knowledge. Light conversation, lots of laughs. Dad would typically be fairly quiet in the group, but now and then, to everyone's delight, he'd score a round of laughter with a perfectly timed one-liner. One day, as we were leaving, a woman was exiting with a large takeout order. If there was a child in the room, the maternal instincts of Dad had just taken her. This woman was exiting with a large takeout order, and she started to look over her shoulder to find out where her daughter was. Dad noticed a little girl at the far side of the room, and there was a huge crowd separating them. Before the mother even knew what was happening, Dad called out in his commanding headmaster voice, Attention, please! And he smiled, lowered his voice, pointed at the little girl. The crowd parted. And with a grand gesture and a royal bow of sorts, he said, Princess, coming through. I want to stop one line. Our thanks to the staff and the caregivers at both Woodcrest and the New Hampshire Veterans Home. All that they did to help Dad. And about a month or so before he passed away, one of the nurses called me over and said, we, the family, needed to know that Ron just always tried to be upbeat. Clearly, she said, he must be uncomfortable. And continues to be such a gentleman. So even as things were fading for him when you visited, you found him with a good-natured smile, a firm handshake, and still playful and helpful at any opportunity. I don't have a coffee cup in my hand, but cheers.
Thank you, Don. And Michael, is that? First, I'd like to thank everybody for coming today. It really is a comfort to see so many people take time out of their day on this beautiful Saturday. Before there was a bumper sticker saying, "This car climbed Mount Washington," Ron Hill was already leading ski trips of UNH students to conquer Tuckerman Ravine. Before Tom Cruise was Top Gun, Ron Hill was already an officer and a jet fighter pilot in the United States Air Force. Before Sun Valley was a ski resort for the rich and famous, Ron Hill had already skied their blades and boards. To his children, Ron Hill truly was the most interesting man in the world. When Dad was in the eighth grade, he met with Mr. LaCase, who was then headmaster of Freiburg Academy and known simply as Mr. Dad wanted to see if he and his brother Dick could live in a dorm room and work in the kitchen to help earn their keep. His stated reason was that bus service didn't make it all the way up to North Chatham back then. His real reason was he wanted to get off the farm. In Dad's words from some notes he wrote to us kids, "I had butterflies in my stomach as I knocked on Mr.'s door. I think I interrupted his supper. Mr. stood at the front door of his house and listened to my brief request. Mr.'s response was briefer yet. I think we can work something out." So at about 12 years old, Dad started working summers at Chute's homestead on Long Lake in Naples to earn money to help with room and board at the academy. He sent his first paycheck home to his father for safekeeping. My grandfather didn't place much value on education, and instead of putting the money in the bank for school, my grandfather bought a calf with it. Dad said that was the last paycheck he ever sent home. Having come from such humble beginnings, Dad was very proud to follow in Mr.'s footsteps to become headmaster of Freiburg Academy in 1970s. And us kids were excited to move to Freiburg and go to the academy where both Mom and Dad had gone. It's my favorite story from when Dad was headmaster. A call came into Dad early one morning from a very nervous-sounding kid. He demanded that school be canceled that day. As the kid was getting to the point that this was a bomb threat, which is clearly where the call was headed, Dad didn't let him finish, and he simply hung up the phone on him. Mrs. Gray, Dad's secretary, asked Dad, "What was that all about?" And Dad said, "I don't really know. But if it's important, I'm sure he'll call back." Dad judged the man by his handshake. Anyone who met Dad got two firm handshakes, one at hello and one at goodbye every time. As dementia set in, you might get four or five handshakes. With the possible exception of Uncle Carol or Cousin Conrad Eastman, Dad had the strongest grip in the extended family. His advice was, have a firm grip. Don't try to crush their hand, but don't give them a dead fish either. Having said that, he could crush your hand right up to the end. I'll end with a few Ron Hill sayings. His response to the cost of any item, cheap enough at half the price. His response to how his food tasted, better than nothing, and I've tried both. His pronouncement upon finishing a do-it-yourself project, close enough for government work. His proud announcement to us kids every time we drove past the Jackson-covered bridge, "That's where I asked your mother to marry me." Even at 85, this is even harder than it looks. Even at 85, Dad's answer to "How you doing, Dad?" was always an enthusiastic, "Not bad for a young fellow." Not bad indeed.
likes water.
Yeah.
Summer of 1980, after I finished my freshman year at Freiburg Academy, and Sarah had graduated, the boys were off on their own. That summer, we moved away from Freiburg to Durham, Connecticut. And that's where we lived during my remaining 3 years of high school, when I was the only kid at home. Dad was teaching science at Lyman Hall High School, and Mom worked at the bank. And those years, Dad usually had another job in addition to teaching. He drove a cab. One of his fares was clearly an academic, and they struck up an interesting conversation. At the end of the ride, the man gave Dad an excellent tip and then asked, "Sir, what is your other profession?" He waited tables at Chateau Bianca, where he wore a long white apron and prepared some of the dishes tableside, and he would have me quiz him on with flashcards to memorize the steps for the Caesar salad or the cherry jubilee. And about these night jobs, he'd always say, "Well, I don't need to do it. You know, I'm independently wealthy." A very fond memory for Mom and me during those years in Durham were what Dad called mystery trips. Mom and I wouldn't know our destination. I assume he did. We'd hop in the car, and typically he'd take us on a pretty drive through the Connecticut countryside, and we'd talk in the car and enjoy ourselves, and then we'd wind up with dinner somewhere neat, like Shady Glen or a seafood place on the shore. And we really enjoyed those mystery trips. I remember him warming my hands with his on my first ride on a chairlift over here at Cranmore. And then I remember him accidentally running me over on that same chairlift ride. Dad liked to keep things simple. He appreciated people. He loved to sit in his lawn chair in the evening and look out at the field and the breeze racing through the tall grass, and he'd look at you and say, "Isn't this kind of nice?" And taking pleasure in simple things really seemed to be Dad's philosophy of life. Dad took us kids seriously. Never let any grown-up tell you your problems are nothing. "You think you've got problems, kid? I've got problems." "Your problems," he would say, "are just as important to you as theirs are to them." At the same time, he thought it was important not to dwell on things. Dad had no better friend than his brother, Uncle Dick, who remained in his memory, along with Alice, we call him Mom, despite his dementia. Uncle Dick was never far from his mind, and just the thought of him grounded Dad and brought him comfort. Dad let me go over and over again, and now that I'm a parent like most of you, I appreciate how hard it is to let your child go, especially your favorite child. On my 21st birthday, he took me to a bar in Brunswick for my first drink, and he told me he had great faith in me, and from now on, he'd never again give me unsolicited advice. He assured me that he would always be available if I wanted his advice or ever needed to talk things through. But that faith in me really took me a long way. He let me go in high school when I dated boys he didn't know. Again, now I know how hard that is. When Dennis LaFontaine dumped me junior year, Dad told me, "Hey, it's the lucky ones who get their hearts broken. People like you putting your heart out there, giving it a try. The really sad ones are sitting at home, never taking any risks." He let me go in Brooklyn, where he drove me and all my belongings so that I could start my new job in the city. So I could get my heart broken again, this time farther from home. And he let me go again when I quit my good job and moved away without a plan to the Pacific Northwest. And that was way back in 1995. Most of these goodbyes involved Dad's little truck and his toolkit and manual labor and free lunch, along with his moral support. And I'm proud of you, kid. He was a warm and generous dad, a cheerful and steady influence. I feel like I've lost my way a little about him. I still need his advice, and I still need to talk him through. I miss him. It's really hard to let him go. But Dad didn't like things to be too schmaltzy, like this. And this the way I ended a letter I wrote to him on his 70th birthday, which was also schmaltzy. Dad, I love you very much, and I thank you for being my dad. You could have done a lot worse. Some of the times I remember most about my dad are times when I was struggling with indecision. He never told me what to do. Okay, well, he probably did that quite a bit over the years. But at times when I needed to work things out for myself, he made a good sounding board. He offered support and didn't appear to judge. He made things possible, but didn't push too hard one way or the other. Generally, driving through one of the notches or watching the sun come up or go down on Mount Washington provided comforting and fortifying backdrops for discussing past, present, and future, for putting things in context and into perspective. On one occasion, writes Sarah, a time when I was living outside of Boston and had been toying with the idea of going to graduate school to get a degree in occupational therapy, and had all but decided to give it a pass, Dad drove down to the outskirts of Boston, to Watertown, where I was living, and took me out to dinner. By the time that he kissed me goodbye, I had decided to give it a shot. When I checked my GRE registration, I discovered that the test was that weekend. I hadn't even remembered when the test was and would have blown it off completely if Dad hadn't come down when he did. Long and short, I took the test and got my degree and have been gainfully employed as an occupational therapist ever since. Sarah writes, I've missed these aspects of my dad for quite a while now. But I've been fortunate to continue to feel accepted and loved by him, even when he may not have been certain who I was. In my experience, he was the type of man he had hoped he would be. Kind, gentle, and cheerful, right to the end. And although I may not have always made the choices he would have wished for me, my visits with him these last few years were undoubtedly made more rewarding by the profession he helped me to decide on. So thanks, Dad. I love you and miss you terribly. So I now have the honor of giving a more formal eulogy, sharing in somewhat chronological order the events of Ron's life. Ronald Wentworth Hill was born almost 86 years ago in North Conway, New Hampshire. He was the third child of Donald Wentworth and Loretta Hatch Hill. He and his brother and sisters grew up in various locations in and around North Conway, and even spent a brief time living in Yarmouth, Maine. As a teenager, as we've already heard, Ron attended Fryeburg Academy, and upon graduation from Fryeburg, Ron and Dick went to UNH. Sometimes, I'm told, alternating studying and working in order to support one another through school. Ron received his bachelor's degree from UNH in 1954. Ron was ROTC. He served in the Air Force from 1955 to 1958, earning his wings from Jet Fighter Training School in 1956. He also served later in the National Guard. And after he retired, Ron was a proud member of the Gray Eagles. His time in the Air Force, as we've heard, was very important to him. And some of the friends he made there have been friends for life. Ron first met Alice in 1952, when Ron was home from college for the summer. They met at Diane's house. Diane was Ron's cousin and Alice's friend from high school. They met in the kitchen. Isn't that where things always happen? They met in the kitchen where Alice happened to be doing dishes. Perhaps not an auspicious start to a relationship. But thankfully, they met again 6 years later, not around the dishes, when both of them were home for the summer. Alice was back from a year of teaching school in Pennsylvania, and Ron was just out of the service. They started dating, and the rest, as they say, is history. They married in 1958 and began their life together. Over the course of his career, Ron taught physics and chemistry in a number of different schools. We've heard many of them mentioned already. I'll just list some of them. Brewster Academy in Wolfboro, New Hampshire. Lyman Hall High School in Wallingford, Connecticut. And Choate Rosemary Hall, also in Wallingford. At Choate, Ron served as chair of the science department during the time when they were planning and constructing a new science facility. And in his position as chair, Ron also served as lead consultant to the renowned architectural firm of I.M. Hay, who designed the building. It was a joy for Ron to compare notes and speak with I.M. Hay. There were also times in Ron's career when he served as an administrator. He was principal of various schools in Newington, Connecticut, and as we've heard, headmaster of his alma mater, Freiburg. While in Connecticut, Ron also went to graduate school, earning his master's degree from Central Connecticut State University and completing all of the coursework for his PhD at the University of Connecticut. Something to be proud of, for sure. When Ron retired in 1996, he and Alice moved to Jackson and then to New London in 2011. In Jackson, Ron continued to be so active. He was active on various church committees, served on the board of the Water Precinct, and was president of the Jackson Historical Society. And of course, he continued skiing. Can you raise your hand if you've witnessed his skiing? Any of you here? Yeah, I'm guessing many, many people here. As it mentioned already that Ron taught skiing for Arthur Doucet in the winter of 1954 to 1955, and he raced into his 70s. Everyone describes Ron skiing as graceful, the epitome of grace. I think it's fair to say that while all of these activities, especially those related to education, were extremely important to Ron, family was most important. Growing up, in addition to his immediate family, Ron was close to many members of his extended family, including his Aunt Ora, Aunt Ludi, Uncle Nod, among others. Ron loved his wife, Alice, and their 4 children, Don and Mike and Sarah and Susie. And I know that he was immensely proud of all of you, of your accomplishments in life and of your integrity of character. I'm sure that he was equally proud of his grandchildren and great-grandchild, as well as nieces and nephews. I am also sure that all of you, family, friends, are similarly proud of him, proud to have known him, proud to be related to him, proud of his accomplishments, of his integrity of character. Ron's daughter Sarah, with Alice's permission,
shared with me some of the comments that people wrote about Juan in condolence comments. Card after card from friends and relatives, and even from recent acquaintances, referred to Juan's kindness, his caring, his warmth, his good-humored, welcoming presence. A number spoke about his smile, his infectious laugh, and a number mentioned the twinkle in his eye. You can kind of see it in a picture that's on the front of the bulletin. And one person even referred to, and I'm quoting here, that little devil in him that made him so much fun to be around. And now, for Juan, earthly life has passed. He has let go of the body, which had become weak. And I believe that his spirit, little devil and all, is now more fully connected to the love that was so beautifully described in the reading from 1 Corinthians 13, the love that never ends. You may be sad today, of course, but may you all also be proud, because you have known and you have loved Ronald Wentworth. We move now to a time of prayer. And I invite you, before we pray, just to take a breath, maybe find a Kleenex if you need one. And just a word about prayer. I'll pray, and then we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer, and we'll be using the version of the Lord's Prayer that uses debts and debtors. If you're a trespasses person, feel free to whisper that. God's okay with it, I'm sure. So may we be in a spirit of prayer. Oh God, gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of your love shown to us in Jesus of Nazareth. In Jesus, you have disclosed the nature of your love and shown us that your love has no limit. We remember now before you Ronald Wentworth, giving thanks for the gift of his amazing life. We remember him for himself, for the unique qualities and values that made him especially who he was. His kindness, his commitment to education, his sense of humor, his love of family and friends. We thank you, O God, that his sins are forgiven, that all suffering and pain he may have experienced is forgotten, and that he is at peace in your eternal presence, reunited with other loved ones who have gone on before. Help us to be content to release him to you, gracious God. Assure us that with you, his spirit is safe and happy and more complete. Surround us and all who mourn today with your continuing compassion. Do not let grief overwhelm us, dear God. Do not let grief be unending or turn us against you. Assure us of your presence with us at this time, that casting all of our pain upon you, we may know the comfort of your love. We pray in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. And hear us now as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
We're grateful for the stories that Ron's family has shared with us. And we understand that each person here will have known Ron in a different way and will carry your own stories. And we hope that you will share those stories with each other and that Ron will live on in those stories and in his family and his friendships and the love that endures relationship to relationship. We invite you now to rise, if you are able, to sing once more together. This time we'll be seeing All Things Bright and Beautiful, which again you may find in your bulletin, or also in the red hymnal, page 63. From the moment it first laid eyes on you, this blessing loved you.
This blessing knew you from the start. It cannot explain how. It just knows that the first time it sat down beside you, it entered into a conversation that had already been going on forever. Believe this conversation has not stopped. Believe this love still lives, the love that crossed an impossible distance to reach you, to find you, to take your face into its hands and bless you. Believe this does not end, that the gesture once enacted endures. Believe this love goes on, that it will still take your face into its hands, that it presses its forehead to yours as it speaks to you in undying words, that it has never ceased to gather your heart into its heart. Believe this blessing abides. Believe it goes with you always, and believe it knows you and it loves you still. Go in joy, go in comfort, go in peace.